Hello, everyone. It's Asus McDonald here. Thanks for tuning into the show. If you haven't subscribed yet, take a few seconds to subscribe because I don't want you to miss out on any valuable content around entrepreneurship, around business, and around marketing. We have amazing professionals on the show, and we do our best to provide you with valuable content on a weekly basis to help you scale. So make sure you take a few seconds right now to subscribe to the show. And for those that have been listening to our show for some time now, thank you for being a valuable and loyal listener. And please leave us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts. It would mean the whole world to me. And why it would mean the whole world to me, right? Because I'm always asking people to subscribe or leave a 5-star rating, is because by giving us a 5-star rating, it helps us to reach a wider audience. And we definitely need your help to spread this like butter, okay? Also, as a reminder for podcast interviews, just like this one, you can also watch the video version of those interviews on my YouTube channel. Just search Asus McDonald on YouTube and you'll find those videos there. There's not too many Asus McDonalds out there, so it should be easy to find me. Now, today, my guest is Nicole Adkison. Nicole, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Same here, same here. I want to start by giving our listeners and viewers a short bio of who you are to give more context, and then we'll dive into the questions that I have for you. Now, for those out there that don't know Nicole, Nicole Adkison is an estate and business planning attorney with a background in finance and taxation. Having been self-employed since she was 18, she started her law practice straight out of law school and has been helping clients create, plan, and grow businesses with the extensive knowledge of having personally been there and done that. She is a certified legal specialist in taxation for the California Bar and uses her background in tax to help facilitate her clients' estate and business planning goals while minimizing the impacts to their bottom line. Nicole's main goal is to help demystify the legal process so that her clients feel empowered to do the thing they love without worrying about the liability behind their passion. That's awesome. Creating a company and following your dreams is already challenging enough without the legal system making it any harder. Nicole, again, thank you for your time today and thank you for joining the show.
I'm excited to be part of your new endeavor. I think this is a fantastic thing that you're doing.
Yes. And you are the first business attorney that we have on the show. A lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of small business owners out there, and even marketing professionals, there's some that are thinking about starting their own company and they don't know how, when, they don't even know what the legal standpoint is for that and how to go about it. So a lot of great questions that I have for you. Let's dive right in. Let's start off by what inspired you to become a business attorney?
Well, long story short, I actually had no intention on becoming an attorney. I planned to teach, but once the stars aligned and I was going in this direction, I have been self-employed since I was 18. My dad started a company when I was 2. And so I grew up in the small business atmosphere and I've gotten to see what the challenges are that they face. And yeah. So I'm hoping to help facilitate the legal process and make it a bit easier for people. So that's really what got me into the business section of law.
That's interesting. Now, what differentiates your practice from others?
You talk to my clients and they'll tell you. I am not a typical attorney. I'm not the stuffy formal type and I have no problem with them. I'm just not that person. I'm a very personable, very collaborative, very relationship focused. Mm-hmm. You know, we're taught in law school, the CYA, all people are taught, all professionals are taught CYA, you know, cover your behind. And lawyers take that to an extreme because they know that the things that they say, the legal advice that they dispense, allows their clients to do something or not do something, and they can be held for malpractice if it's not right. And there's all this liability right. Hanging around. And though I do take those things into account, I really focus on the relationships between the parties more so than the legal aspects, because I think that that's what creates the collaborative environment to allow business professionals, business owners, and their contractors and vendors to work out their differences without all of the lawyers and litigation and things that you really need the CYA for.
No, totally. It's hard because it's kind of like a doctor, right? You don't want to give the advice and, you know, it ends up going south for them, right? And at the same time, you want to make it relational and you know what's the best in their interest, right? What's best for them. So I can see both, sides, and that's a very difficult position to be in. Now
it can be, but it doesn't have to be.
Yes. That is very true too. Now, if I wanted to start a business, what legal advice would you give me based on what we just talked about?
Well, the best legal advice I can give is to follow your intuition. Something I tell my clients on a consistent basis is if it doesn't feel right, it probably isn't right. And more than any advice, more than any legal stuff I can tell you, following your intuition is really the best thing you can do for your growing business. Now, set that aside for a second. And the best legal advice I can give is know what you're getting yourself into. Do the research, do the legwork, do the hard work it takes to know what the legal requirements are. And if you're starting a bricks and mortar business or if you're starting an online business, makes no difference. Online, you have a little bit more challenges because your presence is everywhere. So you have to know the laws and the rules and the regulations in all the different areas of the places that you touch because of the interstate commerce rules. And so because of that, knowing all the steps that you need to take to be in compliance with all the laws and all the places is probably the best legal thing I can say.
Nice. And you touched a little bit about online, but does that advice also change if I wanted to start an online business?
No, it doesn't change. There's just a lot more to be aware of for online businesses. Where you incorporate or where you form your LLC, what tax rules. So in California, we have the Franchise Tax Board. You have an $800 plus fee that you have to pay them. And there's all sorts of paperwork and all sorts of requirements and reporting things that you need to know.
Right.
And so there's the basic business stuff of, you know, you have to pay your FTB fees and you have to do quarterly payroll taxes and all the things for operating a business normally. But then there's all the extra rules and regulations surrounding whatever industry that you practice in. So I have restaurant clients and there's a whole gamut of rules related to food safety standards and related to HR stuff. And so, know your industry well and know the rules and regulations around it.
Would you say, maybe from a legal standpoint, it's more difficult to start an online business compared to a non-online business?
No, they each have their challenges. With a bricks and mortar business, if you're going to have space at all, I mean, if you do it out of your garage, that's one thing. Right. But if you're going to have a space to operate out of, you've got leases and you've got commercial liability insurance and you've got all of the things that surround the actual premises. So instead of the online platform and all of the online things you have to do, and you're a digital marketing professional, so you know all of those things that have to go along with the online presence. That same thing with the bricks and mortar, it's just a different type. There's just as many hassles, and I say hassles because it's kind of a pain, but it doesn't.
Yeah, I think the two scenarios that ran through my mind was like Amazon e-commerce website, right? There's so many things that go on that platform other than just consumer only, right? There's the affiliate program. There's a lot of other partnerships, right? And then I also think about Uber and all this. You know, they're talking about independent contractors, employees, like what's the difference and why aren't they having,
and that's that. Yeah.
That's messy. I mean, so on so many levels, it's so messy.
That's one thing that people who operate businesses, more than most things, other than knowing the basic requirements of starting and operating a business, the employment laws surrounding having an employee versus having an independent contractor is enormous. The liability there is, especially in the state of California, is really, really sticky. And so I cannot stress enough to make sure that you properly classify the people that you work for. That's one of the biggest things that you need to pay attention to being your own boss.
Wow. Yeah. Especially in California. I mean, they audit that. I mean, yes. They're always auditing, but I mean, that's something serious to really think about. You know, I had a friend that, has his own marketing agency, and he said, all of my guys are independent contractors. And I'm like, how did you do that? And it was like, well, you know, a lot of them are overseas and a lot of them are here. But honestly, I just go after just getting them on internships. And I'm like, okay, in Texas, because I was born and raised in Texas, there used to be, I don't know if there still are there, free internships. Like you get to work for a company for free. Yeah. And when I moved to California, I didn't see free internships anywhere, right?
Go to law school.
I didn't see that anywhere here. And my wife is a CPA, and, you know, she also does, you know, tax too. So I like that when you said taxation, I was like, awesome. And she was telling me like, yeah, they don't do that here. That you want free labor?
They did. That's right, they did. Well, lawyers actually are the ones who got in trouble for that, I think, more than anybody else.
Seriously?
If you're in law school, that was one of the ways that you got experience, was to intern at a law firm. And everybody worked for free. And it was just, it really got abused probably. But and
it that's got probably abused.
Why the rules changed.
And I didn't even notice that it got taken away. I was looking for like, I don't know, a social media marketer that wanted to get some social media experience under the belt at an agency. I'm like, sure, you can run my social media accounts. Why not? Right. But I didn't think about that. And you have to pay them the minimum.
Just and like file account. All the paperwork.
Yep.
That's right.
Exactly. So that's interesting. That just came to my mind when we started talking about that. But do you have any advice, Nicole, for our listeners or our viewers, if they're watching this on YouTube, that may want to start a business or grow their business?
Well, I've got lots of advice. That's what lawyers do, because it depends is our favorite phrase. But the thing I can't stress enough is to follow your intuition and be reasonable. The cost is always going to be more than what you think. It's always going to take longer, and you're always going to have to work harder than you're anticipating, because starting a business is really rough. It's worth it. And there's a lot of reward with all of those challenges, but more than anything, just keep your eyes open. Keep an open mind as to all of the things that you're going to face. It's not going to be easy. There's no such thing as getting rich quick or any of that stuff that just doesn't, TV makes it sound good, but that's not how it works.
It never happens
and
that
so
way. I've never seen
just
someone
be reasonable.
That.
That's right.
Never seen someone
be reasonable.
Right. No, that's really good advice. Now, if people that are listening to this or watching this, they want to get in contact with you, what's the best way for them to get in contact with you? Maybe it's to learn more. Maybe they're thinking about growing a business. Maybe they're thinking about opening different locations, and they really just need a business attorney to help them think through everything.
Email is the best way to get a hold of me, because that it actually allows us to have a little bit of a dialogue. But if you ask me a question, that gives me a minute to think about it. When I'm on the phone with somebody, it's hard to kind of process all this stuff and give them an answer right then.
Right.
And, you know, obviously we're counseled against doing that anyway, but email is the best way to get a hold of me for things like that.
That's awesome. And one thing we did talk about before, because I think this is really important to emphasize, we talked on a previous conversation, phone conversation, and we talked about how attorneys are portrayed as, oh my gosh, don't reach out to them because they're going to charge you, right?
Yep, that's right.
And something that
that's
I love.
One of those things. Yeah, that's one of those things where you asked me at the beginning what differentiates me. I do not charge for phone calls or emails. If I have to do some kind of legal research on your behalf and it takes me more than 15 minutes, we might have to have a conversation. But for the most part, one of the guiding principles of my practice and the reason that I went into practice for myself at the beginning was that I wanted to do it my way. And my way does not involve charging you for every minute I spend. Now, right. A, I don't have the patience, nor do I have the administrative acumen to do that. But I don't think that it's a good way to do business because I want to provide people with information and a service. And if they choose to hire me for the thing that we're actually talking about, then good. And even once they hire me, still not going to get billed for every minute, still not going to get billed for every email. I don't have the time or the patience.
Right. And for those that are listening, this is why I love Nicole, because it's all about relational over transactional. There's a lot of attorneys, there's a lot of people, doesn't matter if you're an attorney or not, that are more focused on the transaction than more the relational side of it. So this is one of the main reasons why I wanted to have you on the show too, because it's very rare to find someone that is relational. You know, I had one attorney that said, you know, we were on the phone for like 2 minutes and he's like, by the way, next phone call, you know, I'm going to have to charge you. And I was like, I'm not going to call you again. that's basically where it went. Awesome. I was like, awesome. I am not going to call you again. And that was a 2 minute conversation. Yeah.
I can't. My poor husband, he's always chiding me about, he's like, you know, you'd make a lot more money if you'd actually bill for all the things you do. And I'm like, but here's the thing that the money that I don't make, I guess, while not billing my clients for every minute I spend on something is, it's like marketing. I don't do marketing really. People know they can contact me and they will send people to me because they know that they're going to get, you know, advice and service because I care about the thing that they're doing, whatever it is that they're up to. I care about the thing that they're doing and I want to help them along the way. So, it's the, what's it? There's a saying, something about give it out in slices and get it back in loaves or something like that. I'm really bad at it. But there's something along those lines.
But there's something with slices. That's definitely, now I'm hungry.
That's right. Something about bread.
Now, I don't know if we covered this. We did talk about email, but did you mention your email address that people can contact you at?
I did not. It's Nicole, Nicole, at adkisonlaw.com, adkisonlaw.com.
Awesome. And I'll go ahead and I'll put this on the YouTube video in the description. Great. For those that are watching this or listening. And last question, the moment we've all been waiting for here. What is your ideal client? The more specific, the better. Because there's people that are listening to this and is like, oh my gosh, that is me.
Well, I wish I could be that specific, but mostly my ideal client is someone that's excited to do the thing they do and they don't know where to go. So my passion is education. And so the thing that I love and the thing that I'm good at is giving people information and getting them on the right track. So if you're that person that you have this passion in life that you want to do something with and you don't know how to get there, I'm your person.
That's awesome. Well, Nicole, thank you for your time. This has been awesome.
Thank you so much. This has been great. Yeah.
Yeah. No, definitely. And I'm glad that I was able to have a business attorney finally on the show. So.
Yes. Well, have a fantastic day. And thank you so much for your time.
You too. Make it a great day.